Welcome BTGers and fellow denizens of the internet. We are here at the Nürburgring Nordschleife on a very sunny but very cold Saturday morning. As you can see right behind me is a brand new 21 model year Model 3 Performance, delivered factory fresh up to atomic tuning. This will become the new unplugged performance European demo car, which is quite exciting. But before they've started ripping it apart and tuning it, I have actually managed to wangle it for an entire Saturday morning here at the Nürburgring. Except we're not going to be going around the Nürburgring because it is obviously closed. Instead, we're going to be doing something different. I'm going to call this an off-track excursion. So please join me as we go for the first time on the BTG off-track excursion. So a Model 3 Performance is the dual motor with the big 70 something kilowatt battery. It also benefits from 20 inch wheels, performance brakes. It also has a rather cool but understated carbon fiber wing. For the 21 model year, there's a few little adjustments. For example, there's very little chrome now. Everything's black as standard. You've also got the addition of a heat pump for quicker defrosting, which was very handy this morning, and quicker air conditioning. And it's got a power rear lid, so I can actually hit a button now. In terms of build quality, there's a lot of things changed recently. So I had a little look around. You can see the panel gaps are not great. There's a little bit of overlap there, you can see. I mean, this is real early adopter stuff, but at least on this model that I've checked today, and I've checked all of this, it is actually painted all the way around the door edges and into the out of sight areas. Inside, the Model 3 Performance gains not much, actually. It has some nice leather seats, which are available on most of the Model 3s, actually. It does get bespoke aluminium pedals that are only available on the Model 3 Performance. I mean, is that it? That's really it. So without any further ado, I think the pleasure of this car is going to be in the driving rather than the talking about it. So let's go off track. Let's get this first off-track excursion underway, shall we? The first thing you notice, obviously, about driving a Tesla is that it is completely alien and it is from a totally different planet. We do have storks, which apparently they're doing away with on the next Model S. If you saw the if you saw the YouTube videos about that, and it's McLaren-style open-top steering wheel, it's pilot yoke. The Model 3 Performance is really, I would place it against cars like the BMW G80 M3, the AMG C63 and C63S. Really, it's a car of that ilk, and it's priced to match. Even though you're probably saying, no, no, it's a battery car, it's not an M3, it's not got that straight six turbo, it's not an AMG, it's not got that hand-built twin turbo V8. No, but it is the same performance at the same price. If not, I would actually say superior performance, without a doubt, actually. Because while I'm a big fan of cars like the C63, which I think is a mega piece of kit, by the way, it's just a different type of car. It's old school, it's fossil fuel, it's V8, it's petrol. It's all these things that apparently are not hip anymore. Whereas this is very hip and very trendy. Both, you know, with kids on the street and also legislators. But there you go. So is it really a match for the driving pleasure of a G80 M3? I don't know, because I've not driven the G80 yet. C63 is actually my favorite of that entire family so far. And let's break it down by numbers first, shall we? This is allegedly a 455 horsepower car. This is the 2021 model year car. It had its last software update on 2020, December by the looks of it. This should be 455 horsepower and about 640 newton meters of torque, driving through all four wheels through two motors. Let's compare that to, for example, the BMW G80, which I believe is about 470 horsepower and is about 620 newton meters. Very similar power, very similar torque. The next thing you're probably going to say is, but Dale, doesn't the Model 3 weigh like nearly 2 tons? Well, thank you for saying that. Yes, it does. The EU curb weight, which includes all fluids, tires, air in the tires, water in the battery, the 12 volt battery, obviously, you don't put water in the lithium battery. The EU curb weight for this car is 1919 kilos, just short of 2 tons with a driver. The EU curb weight of a C63, moderately spec'd, is also 1860 kilos. A G80 M3 in rear wheel drive only is also over 1800 kilos now. So really this is like one passenger away from being the same weight as an M3 or a C63. And it's got a 74 kilowatt battery and it accelerates basically like the BMW and AMG can only dream of. This is the road from the Nürburgring Breitscheid entrance going up the hill. Going up the hill to Hort Acht. Now I am on cold tyres. They are the performance tyres, the Pirelli P0s in the 20 inches. And we are stuck behind a Jeep. But the performance of this is an easy match. An easy match for any M3 or C63. Underneath, let's call it 200 kilometers per hour, 125 miles an hour. The Model 3 performance will decimate both of those cars. 0 to 60 is crazy in this car. We'll go and do a bit more of that out on the open roads, because don't forget, of course, we don't just have some of the finest driving roads in the world, we also have the finest autobahns in the world. I mean, this is a very fast car out of the box. Let's hit this autobahn. And this is my run. We go down the autobahn to the bridge, over the bridge, and hop off again. And that's it. So let's get there as fast as we can. Are you ready? 80 kilometers per hour, rolling on, not rolling on, flattening it. Whoa, mother lover. It's that. Instant snap. Anything under 100 km, all four wheels just take as much torque as the tires can manage. Now top speed isn't going to be that much of a thing. I've had some big jags down here at 300 km or more. That's 263. So we're on the limiter already. That's as fast as she goes. I mean, that's fast, right? I'm shouting. I shouldn't need to shout. It is quite noisy. I can hear a lot from the panel roof. I can hear my A-pillars quite a lot. But I'll have you know that even like a Porsche Panamera or a Jaguar XJR, which is a real nice interior NVH car, you know, the interior sound is a lot lower. Both of those cars also make a bit of noise at these kinds of speeds. Right, I rolled off there to go past the trucks because there was a chance that the truck behind might have overtaken the truck in front. Yeah, I love the autobahn and I love going fast, but as soon as my visibility drops or there's other traffic involved, my 100,000 miles of autobahn testing per year tells me to just keep a little bit in reserve. So we're just going to cruise along here at about 140 miles an hour to the next junction. Squirt it up to 240, that's about 145 miles an hour. And we're just cruising. We are just cruising. What a thing. It's electric, it's just batteries. Okay, So does the Tesla Model 3 Performance make a cool Autobahn car? Oh my God, yes. Would it go very far at those speeds? No, I don't think so. We just wiped off about 70 kilometers of range in about 10 or 15 kilometers of driving. But, you know, for everything there's a trade-off, right? Well, a beautiful morning to be driving through the Eiffel in a brand new performance car. A performance EV. I mean, this is an electric vehicle that is a performance car. It's not an electric vehicle that delivers your milk in the morning. It's not an electric vehicle that enables the postman to drop off 1,000 parcels with a low carbon footprint whilst not waking up the local politicians. This is a electric car that is designed from the ground up to be a performance car. And I really appreciate that. I think that's super cool. I think that is really super cool. Oh, look at these lovely turns in my lovely four-wheel drive. Whoa, nearly 700 newton meter performance car. Whee! I mean, this is mega. I love driving this. Let's head back up towards the Nürburgring. We have so many great roads around here. The acceleration. Now, if we were to carry on straight ahead, we would find ourselves at the Brunchen car park, but we're not. We're going to take another detour off through these beautiful Eiffel twisties. Head down to Herresbach, Langenfeld, and that way. We've just lost the sound of, you know, a big V8 or a straight six twin turbo or some sort of high revving four cylinder. And instead we've gained a lot of body noise. Now, objectively, this is a quiet car inside. It is a quiet car, but subjectively, you hear a lot of the body movements and you hear a lot of trim. And I don't think you'd notice so much in something that was heavier and something that was V8-ier with a big gearbox and stuff like that. There'd be a lot of vibrations coming through that would damp all of that. Or mask it would be the better term. There is an interesting sub-note that you don't notice the first time you drive it, but after you've driven it a few miles, you realize you can hear a high-pitched 10 to 15,000 kilohertz whistle, and it's best likened to the whistle you hear sometimes if your dishwasher is just starting to heat the water up. Or the washing machine heater element is on. It's the sound of a lot of electricity running through a lot of different capacitors and transistors and all kinds of electronic gubbins. And it's like, shh, like a... And when I hit the full gas, I can hear the piped in noise that Tesla actually produce, so you know you're hitting some sort of acceleration. But I also can hear this little whistle. Ooh, holy moly. The suspension is pretty good. The body control is good. one of the things about fully electric cars and cars that are designed from the ground up to have an electric powertrain is that you can keep the mass very, very low. Much like a Porsche 911 or a Subaru Impreza, you can get the weight between the axles and not too high. And actually, you can put the batteries almost below the axle line in a car like this. And that does wonders for the body control. Oh man, which way should we go? Let's go this way towards Bar. You've got that four-wheel drive attack feel in this Tesla, but it's not really what you would call the classic petrol heads car, is it? This is like the early adopters, iPhone 12, I've got the latest Nvidia graphics card. It's that kind of car, isn't it, really? This is the Nvidia GTX 3090 of the performance car world. And I mean, I know I'm supposed to be doing the world a favor by driving an electric car, right? But am I still doing the world a favor if I absolutely plant the gas pedal, the speed controller pedal, every time I accelerate? Oh, whoa! That's just fantastic. Oh man, so many people are into electric cars because they're like, I'm going to save the earth, I'm going to save the world, I'm doing the right thing, I'm buying an electric car. I don't subscribe to that theory at all. I can see that to make a car like this requires vast amounts of big smoky factories digging crap out of the ground and then refining that crap and refining it again and refining until you have, you know, your 74 kilowatt hour battery pack. It takes a lot of energy to make a car like this. So the energy that you save driving on an everyday basis is, in my opinion, simply moving the carbon problem around the world. And it's moving it away from the neighborhoods where you will drive this car and moving it into the neighborhoods where that car is built. No, let's be more specific. It is moving it into the neighborhoods where this car's parts are constructed, forged, milled, chemically mixed, refined, and refined again. That's where the carbon print goes. So the places that are making the battery cells and chemically composing them, the places that are making the steel and the aluminium, that's where your carbon footprint goes for the first few years. After that, sure, you know, if you have one of these and run it for 10 years, you'll be in a much better carbon position than a petrol car, provided that the country you live in is actually burning decent things for fuel, you know? Not like brown coal dug out the ground by big diesels, like Germany has, but shush. We're going to go up and pick up my friend Ali. He's never been in a Model 3 Performance ever before, so I'll be interested to see what he has to say. He is your archetypal petrol head. He works every day hand-building Aston Martin Vantage V8s for customers. You may have seen the Valiant Ecosse retro mod car on road and track. He races GT4s, he does all kinds of stuff. He's a petrol head, 100%. So I'm going to be really interested to see what he makes of this electric car. So Ali, do you want to explain who you are?
Yeah, in what context?
I don't know, like for people that don't know you. The context of people like, who's this guy in sunglasses and a hat and a mask trying to hide their identity in a car?
Just not your next Uber.
No.
I'm Ali Robertson. I live at the Nürburgring also, so another expat. I've got a company out here doing... So am I allowed to promote myself, or is I just...
You can say what you do.
Company tuning Aston Martins for, you know, doing services and tuning up to GT4 track level stuff as well. So known Dale for, what, 5 years now? So
yeah,
various bits
a few years. We've raced together, Spa.
Raced together, yeah, in C1s. And, yeah, done some other silly stuff on and off camera.
So what's your, like, no holds barred, what do you think of Teslas?
I kind of, it's weird, at first I had the whole kind of, oh god, electric cars and all that sort of thing for the first couple of years, like, you know, 10 years ago when it was first coming, when there was the Roadster and all that sort of stuff, which was just like, oh, you've just made
a super heavy Elise.
Yeah, a lease, and you made it heavy, you sent it to space, which was the best thing you could have ever done. Hopefully it's just disappeared now. And then, you know, the more they became sort of usable and actually more interesting, and they kind of did a whole marketing on how fast they were and stuff, I was like, okay, you know, you've piqued my interest a little bit. Then I started to think, you know, actually it would kind of work for me when I was in my old job. My old job was only, you know, 7 kilometres from here. I could plug it in here and at work, and fucking hell. Yeah, and then I had a go in one. It was a Model 3, not a performance, so just a bog spec, a standard spec type thing. Jesus Christ. Oh Christ, it stopped as well.
Oh yeah.
And it was like, okay, I want one. And I tried to convince my mum to get one actually as well. She's a bit of a petrol head. Fucking hell. Excuse my ear. You said don't swear, but it's quite difficult.
It's
so punchy, isn't it?
It's really punchy. You just go.
My God. The thing is that the lack of sound means you need to be even more aware of what you're doing, because you don't get that climb and engine note and that awareness of sort of drama, you know.
Yep.
The drama just comes from what you're doing, and you kind of quite quickly,
you don't realize, but as a motorcyclist, as a race car driver, there's a lot of cues, isn't there, going into your subconscious, telling you things like, we're at 8,000 RPM, we're in fourth gear, and it's all telling you how fast you're going.
So is this on winter tires?
No, this is on summers.
Okay, right. And what brakes is that on?
This is the Model 3 Performance, so it has, like, I think it's about 340mm brakes or something.
Okay, so not massive.
Four-pot Brembo type stuff. Yeah. It's not a Brembo, but it's a four-pot opposed to two pistons opposed.
Okay.
Four pots total.
Right. It stops, though.
Yeah, stops nicely. It's got good brake pedal feel, despite the mixing of the channels of the regen plus the actual physical braking.
Yeah. What do you think is the final sort of nail in the coffin that will drag petrol heads away from thinking these are a novelty factor into actually a viable performance,
I guess,
weekend car?
Do you know, my theory on it is that it'll depend on the infrastructure around every driver, because if you're in the market for something like this, and you see a new charging station go up at your office or a new charging station go up at your everyday supermarket, you'll be like, oh, this makes sense to me.
Yeah.
But if you're living somewhere where there's not a charging infrastructure, then you'll think, oh, it's going to be a pain in the arse. You know, I'm going to have to drive into town to find a fast charger before I even start my journey to, you know, 200 kilometers away.
Yeah.
Because this has got good range.
I mean, for me, the range would be more than enough for what I would use it day to day. One of the sort of reasons that I couldn't afford it, I mean, apart from the fact I physically couldn't afford it, was because the boot space was the problem.
Yeah.
I wanted an estate, and I'm absolutely shocked that they've never gone into this performance estate territory yet.
Well, because, it would make sense, wouldn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know whether...
Like the 3 Series Touring, like the C63 Touring.
Exactly. I mean, for me, I wanted something that almost bridged the gap into a van.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm doing short distances. You know, my diesel van that you saw there, it doesn't even heat up by the time I get to work. I have a stand heating, and it's still not hot by the time I get to work, which means your fuel economy in the diesel is nothing.
It's atrocious.
Yeah, it's terrible. So the first 5 minutes, you know, you're trying to get the thing warm to actually get some efficiency in it, which is not...
I've experienced the same thing this morning with this car, though, because just like your diesel, it has a cold heart, it takes 20 kilometers to get warm and get into its like optimal economy.
Yeah.
The same thing happened with this. It was -7 degrees. It probably took several kilowatt hours of battery just to heat everything up.
Yeah.
And it did it really quick. This is the new 21 model year car. It's got a heat pump.
Yeah.
It did it super quick, but I could literally watch the kilometers come off the range.
Yeah. I mean, that's what I'm saying. So for here, for me, that it would actually make sense, because the kilometers are so level. Both ends, I've got, you know, my own infrastructure that I can manage and, you know, have it plugged in both ends. It's just, you know...
Do you often have it plugged in both ends?
Why wouldn't you?
Why wouldn't you? Yeah, exactly. Obviously, you want to keep it. You want to keep it full, don't you?
It's for me. Is that, like I said, it's still a novelty factor until the handling comes into play, which this might deal with.
Yeah.
You know, and it becomes a vibe. I mean, the thing is, when's the first time you're going to start seeing these on track days?
Well, sort of they're already out there, aren't they? I saw several of these on track days last year.
Yeah. For long or?
Yeah, know, yeah. Driving all day.
Facetiously, but you know, is it actually?
There's a class two. Yeah, there's a class two supercharger up at the Dorrent last year. This year, there's a class three supercharger in front of the Lindner.
Okay.
So you can head out, do three laps or something,
yeah.
Go up to the Lindner, stick it on the fast charger, 30 minutes later you've got another three laps in it.
Right.
It's not as, you know, time effective as grabbing a schnitzel sandwich and pumping 60 litres in.
This is the other thing of, you know, it's the problem with PCs and why I always find it difficult to buy a PC is like within a year or 2 years is the technology in your model going to be defunct?
Yeah.
Or are you going to be looking at like, oh Christ, I should have waited a year, and then suddenly there's this massive infrastructure that is only viable for
and of course,
cars? Or
if you buy a PC for €2,000 and it turns out that Nvidia are just about to drop a whole new architecture and they're going to do a new graphics card, and your Nvidia PC turns out to be worth like €1,000 next year instead of €2,000, you've only lost €1,000.
Yeah.
But what happens when Toyota come out with a new solid state battery?
Yeah.
Or, you know, hydrogen fuel cells become common and not just something for Neil Armstrong?
Well, the thing is, I mean, money-wise, I watched a video this morning of a guy specking up a Plaid Plus. So,
The Plaid.
Plaid. And it was 181,000
options.
But I mean, still, that's a huge.
And it's still just running lithium battery cells.
Yeah.
It's running the same cells that you find in your laptop.
But 837 kilometer range.
Yeah,
that's quite phenomenal. I mean, that then is an equivalent of.
That's down to Munich on half a battery.
Yeah.
Or down to Munich at twice the speed.
And several tickets.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. I mean, have you Autobahn tested that? Is that
I've already hit the Autobahn with this. It's
and you made it all the way there and all the way back. You didn't just drain it.
No, I didn't do it. I didn't. No, I did. I did top speed in it, and I wiped off 70 kilometers of range in about 25 kilometers of driving.
Sure.
Yeah.
So that is that case. I mean that's the thing.
It's the same as a petrol though. I mean,
Germany is that. Yeah. I mean.
I can take a Range Rover V8 with petrol, and I can make that tank last 600 kilometers.
Yeah.
Or I can drain it in 180 kilometers.
Yeah.
It depends how I drive it. And it's the same with a battery car.
Yeah, but is it the same proportionally? So if you
know, I'd say
a
so.
Graph of, you know, performance versus.
I'd say it's similar. It's possibly erring towards the battery car is more susceptible to it.
Yeah. It's like spaceship stuff.
It is.
And this, and so what is the comparison between this and the Model S Plaid or whatever it's called?
I mean, that's going to be like double the horsepower of this.
Double?
Nearly double, yeah.
My God. Okay.
Yeah, you're talking about 1,000 horsepower in
this,
the
this
in the Plaid S.
Like 600, just under 600 or something?
Yes. Yeah, this is technically 455, but my sensation is that this is a 550 to 600 horsepower car. When I drive it, the acceleration to me is comparable to the Jaguar Project 8. To a Rapide S, and these are 600 horsepower cars.
The difference is, oh my God,
it actually pushes you into the seat.
This is the thing is, I can actually liken that to any sort of petrol
no,
because it's a different power. It's so instant.
And when you drive it, and you realise that it's totally instant between your toe and the floor is everything you want, and there's no cough, there's no turbo spooling, there's no supercharger rotating.
No,
it's just
there's no wind
the
up.
Speed of light. Whoosh.
That's what with horsepower or horsepower effectively in petrol terms.
You feel it kick in.
Yeah, exactly.
We're in the power.
Yeah, exactly. And that this is so instantaneous. It's ridiculous. How does this compare to the Jag E-Pace?
So the I-Pace is the I-Pace is a lot higher. Has a little bit more body roll than this, and does not have anywhere near the torque and the power of this one.
Yeah.
The I-Pace is a fast car, and especially when you're coming out of junctions, it's really easy to surprise yourself by how fast it is.
Yeah.
But it does not feel like this. This feels like I could, like, if somebody came up to me in the M3 competition, I'd just laugh at them.
Yeah.
You know, at Laguna Seca, even just third-party magazines, road testing the cars without any help from Tesla, grabbing cars from the dealer, mm-hmm. are still doing faster lap times around small race circuits than the M3 and the C63. Small as in less than 150 miles an hour on the back straight.
Right.
So Laguna Seca, for example, the Model 3 performance is definitely quicker.
I mean, that's the thing. If you get to terms with one of these on a track and you have that... The thing is how linear is the relationship between the pedal and then adjustability when driving?
It's perfectly adjustable. It's just the same as the I-Pace. It's you get dialed into it really quick. Anybody who's ever drifted a radio controlled car or raced off-road buggies that are electric, you soon realize the torque demand of the battery motor combination is superior to anything petrol. You soon dial into it.
And beyond, this is presumably a tuner model that's
This car belongs to Unplugged Performance, which is a California company.
Yeah.
And they're selling all kinds of parts, whether it's like off-road coilover gravel setups for your Model Y to make it look more off-roady,
okay.
or as they've already done, they hold the lap record at Laguna Seca because they modified one of these and made it super fast.
Right.
And this car is going to get the full treatment and live here at the Nürburgring as the demo
car. But this is bone stock at the moment, or is this?
This is bone stock.
Right. Okay.
This is bone stock.
And I've changed the set of wheels on one of these for a customer. And had a look on it underneath, and I was it's just like, you know,
normal
suspension.
Car.
Yeah, it's nothing like wild there. So obviously that's tunable. That's, you know, your suspension architecture can be modified, changed. It's coilovers, brakes, and all that sort of normal things. But beyond that, you know, is that modifiable? Is that something that's feasible to, you know? Oh, I can, I don't know, change diffs or how aggressive it is, or is it all software then at that point?
There's a lot of software, which means that. If you modify this car, if you do any kind of mechanical tuning, you have to have an eye on the software for sure.
Right.
I believe, and I could be wrong, Unplugged Performance will be looking at things mechanically on this car, like cooling and cooling capacity, and how the software cools the car. Mm-hmm. So they're going to be replacing coolers with bigger coolers, more efficient coolers, and then dealing with the software problems of, you know, if it's going to open the pumps this much, then how... is it going to react to the battery being colder or hotter?
Is that all in aid of just more power for longer?
More power for longer, because the durability of the performance is the key issue on all of the Teslas.
Yeah.
It's something I didn't have a problem with on the I-Pace. It was heavily overspec'd, and I think that's one of the big differences between the manufacturers.
Yeah.
You know, Jaguar, for example, have something they call the EDR, which is the Enthusiastic Driving Regimen. And basically, the enthusiastic EDR testing.
Come up with that name.
Like, EDR.
Like, how many sort of groups did that go through before they went? Yeah, that's.
I think in that typical Jaguar fashion, it was probably one guy with a good idea, and everybody just went, "We'll run with that."
Yeah.
So the EDR regimen, the enthusiastic driving regimen, is basically you drive like a total knob for about an hour in the car, and you do it here on the Nürburgring Nordschleife.
Okay.
And you really try to destroy the systems, so going on in modern cars.
Yeah.
But yeah, the Tesla runs out of puff pretty quick on the track, and that's what Unplugged Performance are keen to sort. Because it's all very well going to Laguna Seca and doing one lap time and then saying this car is the fastest.
Yeah.
But the M3 will probably go around there for 20, 30 minutes without any dramas.
Yeah.
And this will do 10 minutes.
Yeah, and this is what will be the interesting point of when tuners get hold of it. Tuners that have got experience of car dynamics in these circumstances on track days and things like that will then apply that knowledge, and you know that then might jump them forward,
which is where, you know, Atomic Tuning and Unplugged Performance working together, that's going to get really exciting, because they're going to put suspension on this that actually works. They're going to put suspension that complements semi-slick tires. They've got totally different wheel fitments, different widths, different offsets. It's going to get quite fast.
Do you know what suspension they're going for, or
I don't. This is all in the future. This is all to come. Unplugged Performance have their own coilover kit.
Yeah.
Where that technology is coming from, I don't know, because I'm pretty sure they don't have a suspension factory charging up shocks and pulling out springs, you know. And just like that, it's time to take the car back to Oleg, back to Atomic Tuning, and back into the hands of Unplugged Performance. It's been a fun morning with the car. Done some autobahn, done some twisty roads. Really, I felt like within an hour of driving this car, I've gelled with it. Like, I could imagine owning this car and driving it every day. And it must be said, probably doing some track days with it as well. What's really interesting and exciting is what comes next though, because you know BTG, you know me. Yeah, sure, 20 years in the automotive industry, lots of road testing, lots of racing, but I'm really massively into the modified cars and the modifying scene. And what comes next for this car, of course, it being property of Unplugged Performance, is the full makeover, the full Monty, if you will. And seeing how much potential there is just in the standard Model 3 Performance, this is a monster of a car. And to think that it's going to be modified to be even faster, to be handling more like a race car than a road car, is quite exciting for me. I think it's going to be great. And I can't wait to show you more of that. And that's all coming later. How much later? I don't know. At one point, they were talking about getting most of the Unplugged Performance kit onto the car in the next couple of weeks. Certainly, there's some more product development going on behind the scenes as well. So this will become a test bed for future products from Unplugged Performance and Atomic. And this car is going to live here at the Nürburgring as the EU demonstrator, I believe. I love it. Absolutely love it. If you like these videos and you want to know more about the car or more about BTG, then please leave me a comment, ask questions, I'll answer them all. And don't forget to hit subscribe and don't forget to click that bell. Otherwise, the algorithms will decide what you're interested in rather than you. And nobody wants the algorithms to win. Well, apart from, you know, Mr. Google and the Zuck.